invite this French king to meet. When Babri Masjid was demolished in December 1902, all sensible thinking Indian citizens, I am not saying secular, all sensible thinking Indian citizens, whether secular or religious, secular or non-secular, felt deeply distressed and concerned about these things which were taking place. And we wanted to express our anger. We wanted to express our protest to the deliberate attempt of creating a certain kind of atmosphere in the society. We wanted to find a day on which we could express our protest some way or the other in Delhi. And we could not think of any other day except 30th of January. And we took out a procession from Birla Bhavan to Rajghat and expressed our protest. It was a silent march, reflecting, asking people to reflect that what's happening to our society, what's happening to our country. And what I found very interesting in that march, that people who have been criticizing Gandhiji for whatever reasons, from whatever standpoints, who have been describing him as an ideologue of bourgeoisie or even an agent of bourgeoisie, or maybe even an agent of British imperialism, or an impediment in the way of the revolution, were silently marching on that evening, 30th January 1993. We could not find any other figure, we could not find any other place. And why so? And let me hasten to add here, I am not at all trying to say that Gandhiji is important or Gandhiji is great because he was martyred. Even if he was not, I believe now he would have remained as important as he was. Even if he was not assassinated by this man, actually by the idea of illumination. And that I have been thinking about, that what was that which made him so important? What were the ideas, what was the cluster of ideas which gives us some intellectual excitement, some challenge and some inspiration? Again, I am not making a case for everything Gandhiji stood for. I am not making a case for whatever his ideas on this or that subject were. I am just trying to understand that what does he mean today to me as an individual. So it's a kind of sharing. It's a sharing with you of my own feelings and perceptions about Gandhiji. Let me start with underlining the fact that Gandhiji is often described as traditional, and in that sense is usually counterposed to Nehru, the modernist. And some people even go to the extent of arguing that Gandhiji was traditional, Gandhiji was rooted in Indian cultural and religious experience, while Nehru was not. Nehru was a kind of alien to culture. He did not write in Hindi or he did not know Sanskrit that well. Incidentally, Nehru knew. This is just one of the rumors that he did not know Sanskrit. But anyway, we are talking about Gandhi. So, Gandhi is traditional. He reveres tradition. He is respectful for tradition. Let us seriously reflect on this. What do we mean by tradition? Is tradition a monolith? Is tradition something frozen in time? And if tradition is not a monolith, if it is not frozen in time, then being traditional also implies taking a certain stance vis-a-vis your tradition. With what Gandhiji identified in his tradition? And I'm not going into quoting from him his numerous writings. For want of time, I just want to highlight certain acts. In 1915, when Gandhiji came back from South Africa and established his first ashram in Kochara on the river Sabarmati near Ahmedabad, the dominant Hindu tradition was practice of untouchability. That was the dominant tradition. In certain ways, it is still today. In 1915, 100 years ago, you can imagine. So untouchability was part of way of life. In this ashram which Gandhiji established in 1915, there was a Dher family. Dher are comparable with the Jatavs of Uttar Pradesh. So this was a Jatav family, obviously an untouchable. And many of Gandhiji's financiers were very upset. And they wanted him to remove that family from the ashram. Or otherwise, we will not be able to support. We will not be able to contribute to your ashram if you do not remove this family. Gandhiji's blunt answer, to quote, was just one sentence from Rajmohan Gandhi: thank you very much for your contribution, or lack of it, this family will stay. This was 1950. The tradition was practicing and upholding untouchability. Gandhi did not choose to follow that tradition. When he reached Samparan in 1917, his first major political and public act in India, the practice was, or the tradition was, to mark home as the ideal or suitable sphere for people. What Gandhi did in Champa? He took Kasturba all the way from Gujarat and made her work amongst the women of Champaran. And also encouraged his colleagues from Bihar to make women a part of whatever struggle they are undertaking. When we talk of traditions, let us not forget that every tradition has a stream of interrogation. And to my understanding, not necessarily everybody would or should agree with it, I argue in my book on Kabir for something called vernacular modernity. I think the bhakti movement is historically significant and important because it reflects the evolution of India's own modernity in vernacular. I insist in that book and even otherwise that in order to understand the cultural dynamics of India, it is important to learn Sanskrit, it is important to learn Persian, but it is crucial to learn the vernacular wisdom first hand. You cannot understand India if you have no direct access to vernacular literature, to vernacular creation, to vernacular wisdom. Hindi, Bengali, Marathi, whatever. And therefore, if you look at it, Gandhi seems to be closer to the streams of vernacular modernity than to the hegemonic and dominant tradition. Gandhi is not traditional in the sense of justifying everything or defending everything in the name of tradition. Secondly, he did not elaborate upon it academically, but he knew this very clearly. It was almost an existential truth for him. The diversity, the plurality, and the multivocality of Indian cultural experience as a whole. And he knew that you cannot deny this. Denying this would be denying the entire history of thousands of years. And to him, it was not merely a question of Hindu or Muslim. It was not merely a question of Hindu-Muslim unity. It was the question of understanding even Hinduism in its whole proper historical perspective. Let me remind you, friends, the most succinct remark on Dayanand Saraswati Satyagraha Prakash was made by Mahatma Gandhi, who said that it is so disappointing to see such a book from such a talent. Because the essential argument of Satyagraha Prakash, as you know, is that whatever wisdom is there is already there in Vedas, and after that either it's repetition or it is corruption. And Gandhi rejected this view of Hindu history. Forget about non-Hindu contribution to Indian history. But from within the Hindu tradition, Gandhi could not accept the view that something is already done and after that it is either a repetition or interpretation or bhashya or tika or corruption. He could not accept it. And it is not just a matter of academic understanding. It's a matter of recollecting our own cultural experience. Any reader of Ramcharitmanas would realize that it is not at all a translation of Valmiki Ramayana. It is a retelling of Ramkatha, all right, but certainly not a translation of Valmiki Ramayana. Any reader of Sarala Das's Odia Mahabharata would realize that this is not a translation or even retelling of Vedvyasa's Mahabharata. It is an absolutely new construction, new creation on the basic story. And therefore, for Gandhi, unity in diversity, and for Gandhi, or as I would say for Nehru or for anybody or any ordinary sensible Indian, the idea of diversity, the idea of plurality, the idea of multivocality is not a political slogan. It is an articulation of our real cultural life, real facts of life. You cannot do that. I mean, while talking about purity, the idea of purity in culture, the great Hindi scholar Pandit Hajari Prasad Dwivedi remarked, and quite rightly, कि संस्कृति में शुद्धता बात की बात है, संस्कृति में सब कुछ अशुद्ध ही होता है. There is nothing like purity in literature, there is nothing like purity in culture. It is all mixed up. केवल कहने की बात है कि संस्कृति शुद्ध होती है या हो सकती है. We cannot claim purity of race, we cannot claim quote unquote purity of culture, we cannot claim purity of language. And particularly in a country like India, particularly in a civilization like India. Friends, the challenge before our national movement was actually to transform a civilizational entity into a modern nation state. That term Rashtra may be there or may probably is there in ancient Sanskrit scriptures. But the idea of Rashtra or nation, as we understand it today, is a very, very modern idea and essentially an European idea. The fact of the matter is that since the whole world is divided amongst nation states, so this society or any society for that matter has to organize, has to structure itself in terms of a nation state. And now, if that is the challenge, if that is the task, what the national movement could have done except recognizing the fact that you cannot imagine a democratic or inclusive Indian nation if you ignore the very existential plurality and multivocality of this tradition. And Gandhi is the finest example in letter and in deed of this deep realization. That is why he remains important. When today, as Rijvi Sahab mentioning, today when we are told of purity and we are told of pollution, I mean, sometimes I find it amazing. Sometimes I feel like a Baba Ramdev ko jaake kaun batayega Baba lafz kahan se aaya. Wo batayenge to unka vichar ka dil toot jayega. But the facts are facts. क्या करें, बाबा कहीं से आया है लफ्ज, कुछ नहीं कर सकते. सो इन दिस इज जस्ट वन फैक्ट, बट द पॉइंट इज दैट गांधी इंस्पायर्स मी और चैलेंजेज मी और प्रोवोक्स मी प्रिसाइसली बिकॉज ऑफ द फैक्ट दैट ही न्यू समथिंग एग्जिस्टेंशियली एंड ही न्यू दैट दिस इज the condition of being India in modern times, and therefore he fought for it. Secondly, again about the tradition, I mean, Gandhi was deeply grateful to Hindu tradition, to Jain tradition. He was deeply grateful to Islamic tradition. But he was equally and absolutely unapologetically grateful to Sermon on the Mount, to Ruskin, and to Tolstoy. And he had no problem with that. He was critical of his own tradition, and he could hear the resonances of his ideas in the critiques of the Western modernity, like Tolstoy and Ruskin and so on. And when this question was put to him again and again, he actually made this very clear, because the point was that you talk of non-violence, it is not essentially an Indian idea. It is not essentially a Hindu idea. Your overemphasis on non-violence is basically from the Western sources, it is from Christianity, it is from this, it is from Tolstoy, it is from that and all that. Gandhi replied well, that if my ideas on ahimsa are rooted in my Western education or my reading of Western sources, I have nothing to be apologetic about it. And I don't feel like being apologetic about it. Friends, the point which I think draws from this is this. The provenance of an idea, the cultural or geographical provenance of an idea, cannot determine its merit or lack of. You cannot reject an idea merely because it is Hindu, and you cannot accept an idea merely because it is Hindu or it is not Hindu. You have to judge an idea on its own merit. And how will you judge an idea? How will you judge a practice? What is going to be your own parameter? And here I think Gandhi becomes extremely significant even academically, because we are living in an era which started from postmodern and postmodernism, and it has naturally reached to post-truth. There is nothing universal. So how truth can be universal? If there is no universality of method, if science is merely a Western construct, if the idea of rationality is merely a Western concept not applicable to quote-unquote traditional societies, no one is arguing for Eurocentric worldview. One would actually like to criticize that as vehemently as possible. And here I am reminded of the Indian History Congress, where while presiding over Aditya Mukherjee's lecture, Professor Habib recalled that when he was a student of undergraduate classes and he was taught Indian economics, he was told, his generation of students was told about the drain of wealth, about the exploitation implicit in colonial system, and they were told how Britain actually exploited India with all its claim of civilizing and white man's burden and all that. And he was wondering whether we tell these things to our students even now or not. Or colonialism has become something about which everybody wants to express gratitude. I mean, Nicholas Dux was absolutely right when he described that empire was actually an exercise or empire of ideas. Just imagine, look at this. I mean, this is slightly digression, sir. Excuse me. But just look at this. The Muslim fundamentalists are very grateful to British Empire, because it saved them from the tyranny of permanent majority that is Hindus. The Dalits, the only complaint of some Dalit scholars and thinkers to Britishers is that they came late and they left early. And now we have great Hindu nationalists celebrating Queen Victoria for freeing Hindus from the slavery of Muslims. I mean, I think we must credit the imperial epistemology, the colonial episteme, for making a whole society so grateful after such a ruthless exploitation. And not only economic, but also physical torture and intellectual exploitation. It's remarkable that many colors of opinion in this country are actually very grateful to that power. So nobody is talking of a Eurocentric world. But the fact remains that whether Eurocentric or non-Eurocentric, the very idea of proof has to have some kind of universality implicit. We cannot say that this method is applicable here and this method is not applicable here. Everything cannot be and is not culturally conditioned. Today this is a situation where everybody talks in terms of cultural relative age, moral relative age. Every epistemology is equally valid, every tradition is equally valid. No, sir, it is not. Some aspects of certain traditions are not equally valid. They cannot be. And how and why I am saying so? And there is an insight from Gandhi, a great insight. Lloyd Rudolph and Sir John Rudolph, in their study of Gandhi, postmodernist Gandhi, they describe Gandhi's understanding of truth as postmodern because it is experimental and situational. Yes, true. Gandhi's understanding of truth is experimental and situational, but it is not postmodern because with all the experiments, with all the situational variations, Gandhi was very clear that there is some truth with a capital T. Even if it remains perpetually unreachable, as he was fond of reminding through the Euclid's definition of a straight line and geometry. But the idea of truth is there. It is not as if my truth is different and your truth is different. Our perceptions can very well be different. The whole philosophy of Anekantvad is about all that only. But Anekantvad does not negate the very existence of truth. So perceptions can differ and therefore dialogue is important. Therefore Adan Pradan, negotiation is important. I mean, I find it fascinating. As a young person, I used to feel very irritated when I first read this statement, this sentence in one of Gandhi's numerous letters or writings. He was responding to somebody and he wrote something to the effect, and I recall this in Hindi because I read the statement in Hindi. कि मुझे समझौता परस्त कहकर आपको लग रहा है कि आप मेरी निंदा कर रहे हैं। मैं इसे प्रशंसा के तौर पर लूँगा। I am always willing to compromise, without compromising essential moral and ethical principles. That is the point. And therefore, Gandhi made his fundamental parameter very clear. Then in Kerala, the Brahmin priest refused to engage with him on the question of caste and untouchability. And they had their own logic from their own system of understanding and their own way of looking at things. You have no business to talk about the scriptures because in any case you are not a Brahmin. Only a Brahmin can talk about the scriptures. A Paniya has no business to talk about the scriptures. They refused to engage with him. And it was in this context that somebody put a question to him that suppose, let us assume for a theoretical sake, you argue that untouchability is not part of Hindu scriptures even if Varnashram is. And Varnashram is a good idea, untouchability is not. It's a different matter that in later stages of his life, quite naturally as a result of his engagement with Nehru on one hand and Ambedkar on the other, he became quite skeptical about the idea of Varnashram itself. But even if Varnashram is alright and untouchability is not, the question was put to him that suppose if somebody were to prove that scripturally untouchability is also quite right, then what do you do? And the answer to that question from Gandhiji is the thing which I want to emphasize most. Because there you are in the presence of an ethical self who has made certain choices after consideration, after deliberation, after reflection, after a lot of moral quest and moral anguish. Gandhi said that anything coming from whatever scripture, if it is goes against the spirit of this particular mantra of Isavasya Upanishad, I have problem with it. I will not be able to accept it uncritically. And the mantra in question was, Isavasya Medam Sarvam, Yat Kinch Jagatyam Jagat, Ten Tyaktein Bhunjitha, Magrit Kasya Svindhana. The whole world, the whole existence are permeated by the Holy Spirit or Supreme Spirit or Brahma or whatever. And you certainly have a part in it. You have a right to it, but you do not have absolute right to it. Enjoy your right. Don't prevent others from enjoying their right. Anything which goes against the spirit of this month, I am not going to accept. And it was this, friends, which gave Gandhi the moral strength. And in fact, that is the most important thing. We all know everything. Knowing is one thing, acting out is quite another. I can tell you, I am not free to name the name, but this was just before the demolition of Babri Masjid. I had an opportunity of talking to a top BJP, top. And I told him that, do you realize that this is disastrous, whatever you are going to do or whatever you are planning to do, this will be disastrous for the fabric of society. He said that, yes, I do realize. What do you think? Are we fools or what? So then, he was quite simple. He was very frank. He said, look, we have realized, if you remember, in 1980, Bharatiya Janata Party had experimented with Gandhian socialism. The creed was Gandhian socialism. So this gentleman reminded me of that, that we have tried Gandhi, we have tried socialism, nothing is working. As simple as. So he knew everything. So knowing is one thing, and to act upon that is quite another. The importance of being Gandhi is precisely this, that whatever he knew, whatever he came to conclusion as an ethical decision, he acted upon it. And it was not for nothing, I think, the most fitting estimate, ironically, of Gandhi was provided his essay in Nathuram Godse. He said in his statement to the court that the moral influence of this man was irresistible. Therefore, I decided to remove him. And where did he get this moral influence? Because of his moral consistency, because of his courage of conviction, because, as Jawaharlal ji reminded many who thought that Gandhi was using religious idiom only as a matter of strategy or tactics. Jawaharlal ji reminded them, no, Gandhi is genuinely, deeply religious man. He is not using it as a tactics. It's not a question of strategy and tactics for him, it's a matter of conviction for him. The point, however, is that his idea of religion is deeply ethical. His idea of religion is not identitarian. And that is why, for him, to be Hindu did not necessarily mean to hate non-Hindus, particularly Muslims. We are talking of Gandhi now. Just look at the irony, my dear friends. And this is my last submission. As I just recalled, in 1980, after the fall of Janata Party government at the center and return of Indira Gandhi, we had Janata Party divided and Bharatiya Jansangh reinventing itself after Janata Party experiment as Bharatiya Janata Party. And they had their first convention as Bharatiya Janata Party in Mumbai. And there they officially declared their faith in Gandhian socialism. So in 1980, even the right wing was talking the language of socialism. In 2017, even the left and secular and democratic forces are trying to prove their religious credentials. I'm not blaming anyone, I'm not criticizing anyone. I'm just pointing out the irony to this meeting of intellectuals. In 1980, the ideas of modernity, the enlightenment values were taken for granted. They had already become part of popular conscience. The idea of individuality, the respect for individuality irrespective of caste, creed, gender, etc., etc. They were commonsensical, not only in Delhi but also in Kabul, in Europe, everywhere. In 2017, the ideas of cultural identity, the moral difference are dominant. And therefore, it's a different, it's one thing to dismiss or to feel uncomfortable with such political leaders who are trying to prove their Hindu credentials or Muslim credentials or Christian credentials or whatever. As scholars, we have to deeply reflect on that. As an academic, reflecting on Gandhi, to me, is actually a point of departure for reflecting on the whole idea of modernity and enlightenment value. And to reflect on the supposed dichotomy between tradition and modernity. As I tried to tell you in this talk, I do not think there can be any tradition without a potential of modernity or reinventing itself. Or there can be any modernity without a tradition. Gandhi, as an ethical figure, Gandhi, as a political figure, is extremely important. But to me, most importantly, Gandhi is most important and most inspiring as a moral exemplar and actually as a question mark to myself. I was speaking in the department this forenoon about Gandhi and literature. And I was recalling his preface which he wrote for K.M. Munshi's An Introduction to Gujarati Literature. You know K.M. Munshi. And therefore, the last two sentences of this introduction, you would know what did they mean and how deep they would have cut. The last two sentences of this introduction were that how can we talk of Gujarati literature without at all taking into consideration the contribution of Parsis and Muslims. The very idea of inclusion, and not as a matter of grace, not as a matter of concession, but as a matter of fact of life. The very idea of dialogue, without the fear of being hurt. Tejvi Sahab was mentioning my novel Nakohas. Nakohas is an acronym coined by myself. You won't find this word in any dictionary. This is an acronym which stands for National Commission of Hurt Sentiments. Novel is a dark fantasy. A National Commission of Hurt Sentiments has been constituted. And three intellectuals are presented before it and taught the lesson. That don't you dare hurt the sentiments. And the novel proposes the idea that instead of everybody taking out the hurt sentiments in the street, let us have an official constitutional body called National Commission of Hurt Sentiments. Everybody should complain to it, and it will take care of the person who is hurting the sentiments. And would you believe that in one of the readings of that novel in Delhi, in a prestigious college, a young student asked me, "Sir, what is wrong with that?" Can you imagine this? What is wrong with the idea of having such a commission? Yes, this is a good idea. Why Hindu Muslim ko mare, Muslim Hindu ko mare? Isse better hai ki police sab ko mare ek saath. मैंने कुछ कह दिया, आप लोगों की भावनाएं आहत हो गई कि साहब ऐसा आके कह गए मुसलमान तो बहुत बुरा मान गए इसका, तो आप थाने में शिकायत कीजिए, ना आपको मेरी खबर देगा या हिंदुओं की भावनाएं आहत हो. दिस गर्ल, दिस पुअर इनोसेंट गर्ल डिड नॉट फाइंड एनीथिंग फनी और ऑब्जेक्शनेबल, फॉरगेट अबाउट फियरफुल इन द आइडिया ऑफ नाकोस. सो फ्रेंड्स, दैट वॉज 1980. देन इवन अटल बिहारी वाजपेयी एंड Advani were talking of Gandhian socialism. and this is 2017, when you can not criticize any icon without the fear of repression of her sentiments. But yes, everybody can condemn, criticize, even stage killing of Gandhi without any fear of any reaction whatsoever. Let us think about this. Thank you very much.